Greetings. I'm sure I am the only person who is distracted right now. I'm looking forward to the return of the King of Kings. If you're like me, you surf the web weekly, if not nightly, hoping to find or see or learn something new about the return of the Lord. If you have eyes to see and you have ears to hear, you have already recognized the season in which we live. So what should we be doing? What would God have us do while we wait and watch for His return? We should live to please God. 1 Thessalonians 4:1. Finally, brothers, we ask and encourage you in the Lord Jesus to live in a way that is pleasing to God, as you have received from us. This is how you already live, so you should do so all the more. As you have received from us means live by the things already taught. For you know the instructions we gave you by the authority of the Lord Jesus. If you are not hearing Scripture in the church you attend, you must study it for yourself. 2 Timothy 2:15. Study to show yourself approved unto God, a workman that needs not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. You have all you need within you as a Christian. You have the Comforter, the Holy Spirit, who will teach you all things. John 14:26. But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, He shall teach you all things, and bring all things to your remembrance, whatsoever I have said unto you. So, my beloved Christian brother or sister, do not see yourself as alone. The Comforter who lives in you is greater than any threat you face. 1 John 4:4, you, little children, are from God, and have overcome them, because greater is He who is in you than he who is in the world. For it is God's will that you should be holy. You must abstain from sexual immorality. I cannot speak for you, but this slaps me in the face, because Muslims could be one to God if they saw Christians living holy lives. Do not take that personally as an accusation against you in particular, but ponder the last time you heard holiness taught from your church. Modern liberal Christianity is more about tolerance and acceptance than holiness. We tolerate wanton homosexuality and forgive all manner of evil, as we desperately try to show a form of love, we deny that God is holy. Yet while love and forgiveness must be taught, so must holiness. God loves sinners and has provided salvation for us before we love Him. But once we sincerely repent, we need to leave our sin behind. Jesus forgave the woman caught in adultery. John 8:10. Then Jesus straightened up and asked her, "Woman, where are your accusers? Has no one condemned you?" "No one, Lord," she answered. "Neither do I condemn you," Jesus declared. Jesus forgave the woman caught in adultery, then added this, "Now go and sin no more." Jesus called it sin and told her to not do it again. Try to really let that sink in. Jesus called it sin and told her to not do it again. Go and sin no more. For it is God's will that you should be holy. You must abstain from sexual immorality. Each of you must know how to control his own body in holiness and honor, not in lustful passion like the Gentiles who do not know God. And no one should ever exploit or take advantage of his brother in this regard, because the Lord will avenge all such acts, as we have already told you and solemnly warned you. For God has not called us to impurity, but to holiness. Anyone then who rejects this command does not reject man, but God, the very one who gives you his Holy Spirit. Now about brotherly love, you do not need anyone to write to you, because you yourselves have been taught by God to love one another. The word says they were taught by God to love one another. How? I think by the Lord Jesus himself, God in the flesh. John 15:13, greater love has no one than this, that one should lay down his life for his friends. And his final example on the cross of crucifixion. Luke 23:33, when they came to the place called the skull, they crucified him there along with the criminals, one on his right and the other on his left. Then Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. And they divided up his garments by casting lots. Consider how totally consistent Jesus is in his two positions. Jesus voluntarily sacrificed himself, laid down his life. It would be inconsistent to hate or be angry at those executing his will. And I understand one might think the crucifixion was against his will. Matthew 26:39, and going a little farther, he fell on his face and prayed, saying, My Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will. Read for surface understanding, it appears Jesus had a different will about crucifixion. But the moment Jesus decided to do the will of God, God's will became Jesus's will. And if you are Muslim, I want to have a brief side discussion with you. I know Islam makes the claim Jesus was a Muslim. And I know Islam claims Muslim means one who submits their will to the will of Islam's Allah. But Jesus submitted to Yahweh God, the God who sent the prophets. Jesus did not submit to Satan's or Allah's will. From Jesus we learn self-sacrifice is God's will. From Islam you learn murder and jihad for Allah is Allah's will. Now back to our regularly scheduled programming. Verse 10, and indeed you are showing this love to all the brothers throughout Macedonia. But we urge you, brothers, to excel more and more, and to aspire to live quietly, to attend to your own matters, and to work with your own hands as we instructed you. Simply stated, get a job. Then you will behave properly toward outsiders without being dependent on anyone. You should exert yourself to be independent. You should not manage your debt and live on borrowing. Proverbs 22:7, the rich rules over the poor, and the borrower becomes the lender's slave. And after that ultimately pragmatic secular guidance, Paul begins to discuss the return of the Lord. Brothers, we do not want you to be uninformed about those who sleep in death, so that you will not grieve like the rest who are without hope. Those who are uninformed about death are without hope. Those who are uninformed grieve for the dead. Maybe the Word of God is hinting we should not be consumed grieving for the dead. Our hope and our faith is in the resurrection, or at least it should be. For since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, we also believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him or died in him. We will see our dead loved ones again. By the word of the Lord, we declare to you that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will by no means precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will be the first to rise. After that, we who are alive and remain will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so we will always be with the Lord. I sometimes wonder if we consider the meanings of words and phrases. I do not think it crystal clear what we who are alive and remain might imply. And those not inclined to the rapture think this means after the tribulation. Those alive who remain have survived the tribulation. I think that is at least a logically consistent way to apply this verse if you do not expect a harpazo, a rapture. But it does not state after the tribulation in the text, does it? In fact, it also does not refer to the day of the Lord, which is a commonly used key phrase. And there are multiple passages which clearly key off of that phrase, the day of the Lord. Zephaniah 1:14, the great day of the Lord is near, near and rapidly approaching. Listen, the day of the Lord, then the warrior's cry is bitter. Ezekiel 30, verse 3, for the day is near, even the day of the Lord is near. It will be a day of clouds, a time of doom for the nations. Joel 1:15, alas for the day, for the day of the Lord is near, and it will come as destruction from the Almighty. Joel 2:1, blow a trumpet in Zion and sound an alarm on my holy mountain. Let all the inhabitants of the land tremble, for the day of the Lord is coming. Surely it is near. Instead, Paul refers to the coming of the Lord and being caught up in the clouds. I find that interesting, at the very least, when the day of the Lord is such a clearly established event. If nothing else, this should give pause to a dogmatic declaration Thessalonians refers to the day of the Lord. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. Paul says we are to encourage one another. Please rejoice that our redemption from this frail reality draws near. And take this one thought to heart as you live your life for the Lord. Ephesians 6:12, for our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this world's darkness, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Muslims are not the enemy to be hated or cursed. Islam, that deceives them and drags them to hell, is the cancer we wage war against. Know the Word of God and show love, God's love, for Muslims and the rest of lost humanity. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.